Cool. All right, so let me just pull up the file. Plan the United States federal government to establish a domestic climate policy to increase output-based restrictions on private sector GHG emissions and further development of environmentally friendly anthropogenic alternatives, including crickets. Advantage one resource management. Livestock cause climate change from their feed to overgrazing to consumption, increasing demands for livestock and destruction of the environment and other related harms inevitable in 2006. The world stopped to destroy the environment, stopped the car of the planet, the cow. UN reports identify the world's rapidly growing herds of cattle as the greatest threat of the climate, forest, and wildlife. They were blamed for acid rain, the infection of alien species, creating dead zones of the oceans, poisoning rivers and drinking water, destroying coral reefs. The report by the FAO surface the damage done. In almost every case, cattle are most to blame. Livestock are responsible for 18% of the greenhouse gases that cause global warming, with the cars, planes, and all the forms of transport put together. Burning fuels to produce fertilizer to feed to produce meat and transport it. And clearing vegetation produces 9% of all emissions of carbon dioxide. Livestock also produce more than 100 other polluting gases, the major driver of deforestation worldwide and overgrazing. It's turning a fifth of all pastures and ranges into desert, killing coral reefs, and creating dead zones devoid of life. Continued consumption change will drive us past the 1.9 point to extinction of global at 12. The warming that Earth is experiencing now is unprecedented in human history. The pace of the change is very rapid compared to past polar climate records. Could humanity's collective failure to control our influence on climate lead to warming to cataclysmic as to render the planet uninhabitable? If we burn reserves of oil, gas, and coal, there's a substantial chance that we will initiate the runaway greenhouse. As a limit on the emission of thermal radiation is approached, the surface may warm, but no more radiation can escape the upper atmosphere to space. Surface temperature will increase rapidly, finally reaching equilibrium again around 1400 Kelvin, where water vapor settles into greenhouse gas along the way the entire ocean evaporates. Conflict over food stocks will escalate, placing the entire globe at risk of famine, food rise, regional and the further massacre of indigenous peoples, Lopez 98. Ethnic wars can easily escalate in the grapple for building food stocks in India, Pakistan, Afghanistan, the Middle East, Korea, and the Philippines. Splintered insurgency forces may take advantage of the economic drought to regroup and reemerge from the countryside. Then can be sugar between nations with India, North Korea, Ethiopia, and other African countries as first candidates. Food rights, the breaking of law, order, and possibilities will be returned to basics. Food security being a prime concern, and environmental advocacy will be shelved in the name of survival. The current crisis for land and indigenous communities will worsen. Land conflicts will increase with communities being massacred in armed conflicts or dying of starvation. This will further induce wars and conflicts. Entomophagy is a vital component of an effective domestic climate policy. All the elements are there except for the regulatory and governance requirements, polluting 15 and 6 for this great potential to efficiently convert waste organic matter into a high volume source of protein and fat, subsequently producing and refining insect larvae grown on organic waste into a high quality products currently being exploited to produce a sustainable source of feed in the aquaculture and poultry system. This win-win situation provides sustainable solutions for both waste management and food security. However, for this novel production system to be widely accepted, there needs to be robust standards for quality control and food safety, and in particular the potential for the transfer and survival of human pathogens throughout this food production chain. And using crickets for animal feed solves for water scarcity, global food security, and land use. It is a superior alternative source of protein, WAN-15. We have some serious global issues with air access to arable land, sustainable fulfillment, and yields per drop. It's such a far and away one of the best ways to make animal feed stocks more efficient, considering that the effects of climate change, water scarcity, and drought are already evident. There's a huge need for solutions to maintain global food security. Using crickets as feed is an alternative to soy, a common feed component for chickens and other livestock, is one way to help farmers produce more with less and secure about 5 times more water efficient to grow than soy across the supply chain and contain up to 2 times more protein compared to the same amount of soy. And cricket cages, which can be stacked, use up less land than was needed to grow other protein sources. The pathway to low emissions starts with the recognition of the environmental impact of livestock. Now is the key time to push the momentum forward, COP15, to reach the full potential of mitigating the environmental impact of livestock production. Several best practices must be combined. These are husbandry management, prevent performance and health. Efficient nutrient management to reduce feed, resource consumption, nutrient extraction, waste management to reduce waste volumes, and finally efficient management to reduce environmental impacts, followed by efficient energy use, nutrient recycling. The combination of all these elements leads to more efficient and sustainable reduction of emissions and waste and creates new business opportunities. This increases profitability and animal production, low emission farming. Livestock must improve its environmental footprint, given the fact that its resource consumption and contribution to GWP, AP, and EP are substantial. The following recommendations would be given to policymakers, regulatory authorities, and the speed of the development towards sustainable livestock operations. 1. Assess the full environmental cost of current livestock production systems. 2. Exploit the full potential of lowering the protein content of livestock feed. In the long run, using insect protein as a protein source for livestock could contribute a lot to securing the rising protein feed demand and even reduce environmental footprint. The overall findings indicate a positive atmosphere and momentum for change towards the adoption of insects as a new ingredient in animal feed. There is still a big potential to be left to improve the environmental performance of livestock operations to a more sustainable considering. All three dimensions of the sustainable model, all needed elements of the post-LEA content that they already to converge, frequently separated value chains in animal husbandry, energy, waste management, and closed loop approach is a complex task and needs well-managed business models and public-private partnerships and good political and social governance. The intersection of climate change and inadequate food production poses a unique challenge placing large segments of the population in jeopardy worldwide. With billions already engaged, entomophagy represents a unique, underutilized alternative for feed and food that comprehensive studies confirm reduces greenhouse gas emissions, provides sustainable, viable farming alternatives for low-income communities, offers a pathway to a sustainable food source, and is key for global food security. The European Commission is already on board, European, Part 16. By 2050, the population is expected to reach 9 billion. To feed we all, we will have to produce almost twice as much food. We will already use 70% of agricultural land to raise livestock, oceans, overfished environments are becoming polluted. The climate change is crop production. With almost 1 billion people already chronically hungry, we need to buck up our ideas to reduce food waste and make food production more efficient. One possible solution is entomophagy, a common practice that has taken place for tens of thousands of years. Their sustainable food source, their nutritious insect farming can provide jobs and income to people living in poor areas. They have a high fat, protein, vitamin, mineral content comparable to fish or livestock. Consuming insects as opposed to livestock is more environmentally friendly. Insects are cold-blooded, require less energy to maintain their body temperature. This means they are very efficient because they are converting feed into edible body mass, unlike cattle. This means that less land needs to be dedicated to growing feed for insects than for livestock, reducing irrigation and pesticide use. Insects can be used as livestock feed for replacing fish meals. The added advantage of increasing fish supplies available for humans to eat. Insects also require significantly less land than water traditionally farmed. Animals, they also have sustainable shorter lifespans, can thus be grown quickly and farmed in large quantities in small areas. Insects can produce a fraction of the GHG gases such as methane and ammonia compared to the livestock, particularly cattle. They can consume animal waste from plants that people and livestock cannot. They don't compete with the human food supply. They can even help reduce environmental contamination. Okay, cut card there. The entomophagy movement is growing and with it the prospect of decentralized food production. Additionally, entomophagy decentralization can solve for food shortages, Miller and Abbott 16. Insects have been identified as the food of the future, but local traditional practices of eating insects are anything but new. Serious global interest has added a new dimension to the topic. Of the 98 companies known to offer insects as a human food or animal feed, 73 were founded in 2013-2015. An international edible insect movement is emerging. Insects are claimed to be an alternative source of nutritious protein-rich food. If embraced by Western markets, it would argue that insects would replace conventional meat and thereby alleviate the devastating effects of conventional livestock and even provide solutions to global problems such as world hunger and environmental resource degradation. Additionally, it's often thought that entomophagy may have a democratic potential in such a small and easy to breed without much investment capital, and leading this to empower the poor and other marginalized groups such as women and the rural poor to produce their own food, this contributing to food security. Advantage 2, deforestation. Crop supply of leeson-schatz evidence that the livestock industry is one of the main contributors to deforestation. Deforestation causes extinction, circling 15. Rainforests are essential to survival. Rainforests are the lungs of our planet. They produce vital oxygen. Significant rainforests remain. We have to make sure it stays. Rainforests face an urgent threat. That causes extinction, burnouts, wrong Tory, Doken 5. For years, it was believed that microbes slowly evolve towards a benign coexistence. Natural selection may favor extreme harmfulness. The outcome may be the murder of one spouse by the other. A microbe may be capable of eradicating the human race. Okay, and advantage 3, colonialism. Okay, resistance to entomophagy is a message of colonial beliefs extending into the modern day. This sustained mentality is not only toxic for the future of entomophagy, but is also an example of Western exploitation of cultural norms. Rule 15, 2 billion people can't be wrong. We think of insect consumption as being something exotic and very rare, but in many parts of the world, insects are a normal part of the diet. We in the West are the weirdos sending this vast and varied food resource. It's only recently for a few hundred years that some societies decided against it, and insects became something to be got rid of. Colonialism means this anti-entomophagy attitude to spread and force all over the world. Eating insects are seen to be dirty and savage, and the indigenous populations of colonized countries are discouraged or actively prevented from eating insects. In areas where Christian missionaries had a strong influence, such as in Africa, indigenous sides were changed as the new ruling and religious powers deemed insects such as termites to be heathen. The legacy of this history is that there is still a sense of shame about eating insects in some non-Russian countries, especially in places where Christianity took hold. This anti-insect debate is particularly damaging when you consider that insects are an important protein source in many cultures. Okay, the drive to develop and modernize other areas comes from a Western locus of enunciation that's crossed Google 2000. They assume the superiority of the West by creating a time-space distinction between the advanced modern societies and the backward traditional societies. The struggle between the modernization and dependentista theories was a struggle between two geocultural locations. The locus of enunciation of the modernization theories was North America. The ahistorical bias of the theory was an attempt to produce a universal theory for the experience and ideology of the core of the world economy. Okay, and coloniality generates a permanent state of exception that, that is the root cause of the death ethics of war and underwrites a hellish existence where death, murder, war, rape, and racism are ordinary facts of life. That's Maldonado Torres. That human beings become slaves when they are vanquished in a war in the Americas with the suspicion that the conquered people and the non-European people in general are particularly inferior, that they should therefore assume a position of slavery and serfdom. The colony long before the concentration camp of the Nazi politics of discrimination served as the testing ground for the limits and possibilities of modernity, thereby revealing its darkest secrets. It is race and the coloniality of power, and its concomitant Eurocentrism that allow the state of exception to continue to define ordinary relations. Race emerges from the permanent state of exception where forms of behavior that are legitimate in the war become a natural part of the ordinary way of life. In this racial colonial world, the hell of war becomes a condition that defines the reality of the racialized selves. The condemned is a subject to exist in a permanent hell that guarantees a continued affirmation of modernity as a paradigm of war. Okay, I'm gonna go back to the card that I cut about crickets. That I think is Kaufman 15. That's Goldbot 12. Or actually, never mind. I have 2 seconds now, so that's fine. I'm ready for cross.
Okay.
Let me start a timer. Alright, ready when you are.
Okay. What are the restrictions you do to restrict fossil fuels?
Okay, so we're calling for output-based restrictions, right? So what these are is like, okay, so there's two ways to restrict emissions in general. One of them is to cover the inputs, like a carbon tax or a cap and trade, right?
Mm-hmm.
So these penalize polluters in some kind of like graded schedule. The other one is to manage the outputs. So effectively, we go to the individual states and say, you are like being served with a federal mandate to reduce your emissions by a certain amount of, you know, like percentage. In our case, 30%.
Okay.
Do
you restrict fossil fuels? Yes?
We restrict emissions. So, I mean, like, hypothetically, if there was a way that still used fossil fuels with zero emissions, that wouldn't be a problem, right? Emissions are our concern on the output based
emissions.
Okay,
well, we can all agree fossil fuels do lead to emissions, correct?
Well, I mean, so the idea, what I'm saying is, like, people talk about clean coal, for example, right? So the idea is, like, you can burn coal, but take the carbon, put it underground. So we're concerned about the emissions that come out, not, like, the
okay.
fossil fuels that
are
go in.
Are you concerned with emissions of oil?
What do you mean emissions of oil?
Like the emissions produced from oil, coal, and natural gas.
Yeah, so we're concerned about all emissions. Those definitely include, in large part, emissions caused by those dirty fossil fuels, oil, coal, and natural gas.
Okay. And so would you say you restrict electricity sector or transportation?
No,
sector?
I wouldn't say that, because the good thing is that states are responsible for setting these caps. If you have strategic industries like electricity, they might not be served with a cap, right?
So how are you enforcing this when electricity is on hold and natural gas?
So we have a number of other dirty industries, right? That's why we talked about cattle.
Can I just clarify?
Yeah.
Is it a yes for impacting fossil fuels or no?
So I'm afraid you're trying to link us to some kind of oil VA or something, so I'm hesitant to just give you a blanket yes, right?
So you're not giving us an answer?
We're not, like, the states themselves will determine which industries are significant and which ones are going to be cut, right? We can't predict their decisions ex ante. That's not something we're going to try to anticipate or, like, read their minds or something, you know?
Okay, so you're not going to...
I'm not
going
to commit
electricity.
To...
You're not going to impact electricity or transportation sector.
We're not going to commit to doing that. If the states choose to, that's like their prerogative. Like our plan does not call for that. States can use our plan to do that, but that's not our advocacy.
Okay. So you're saying that states can do it?
Sure. Yeah.
Okay. So why do we need the federal government?
Sure. So we need the federal government, like, in one sense, to actually give these states a mandate, right? Like, we don't trust the states to come up with the political will on their own, but we do trust them to implement a federal mandate, right? We also think that federal policies are just more harmonized in general, and we can read evidence on this in the 2AC if you want to hear more on that.
No, that's fine. I think we got it. Okay. I'll be sending out the one.
I got it. Just wanna open it up.
Got it.
Yep.
It's an ordinance. Do you have it? No, it's not that. No. Ordinance files. And then speech. Oh, it's just go to speech chunks. No. So in that case.
nominations, but their willingness depends on calculations from home state on politics. Davis 9, a group of senators highly doubt, highly sought by the White House, are Democrats who are up for a re-election in states that Trump won a bipartisan group to cozy up on Trump's these red state Democrats. As Keith's success, the point of the meeting was to build support for Gorsuch. There's only 52 Republicans. Trump will need 8 Democrats. How open are our red state Democrats? There is inclinations to work together. Just it's a tight rope. 10 Democrats are going to make calculations based on home state politics, where the president is very popular, and plans a law for Trump failure to prevent emissions restrictions trigger backlash from the red state. Monbin 16, wave the magic wand. These pesky pollution laws, carbon caps, and clean power plans switch away. This is Trump's promise. He will tear down and make it true. The governments are making promises they cannot keep. Failure to materialize will mean people become angrier and more alienated. And this causes a shift to nuclear options, spills over to Dodd-Frank repeal. Cost to Trump plans to dismantle the Dodd-Frank regulations. Republicans, if they can't get 60, could cut off the filibuster with 51%. This is going nuclear. The option will wipe out civility, not only the Supreme Court, but on other legislation that Trump wants to pass. This could give the GOP unfettered power. There are ways to avoid this scenario. The way is to compromise and a collapsed EU. Berlin 10. Pledges to roll back on the Dodd-Frank Act, along with the breaks, puts the Don Brovsky's in a precarious situation. The bloc may lose prominence as a financial center of the jurisdiction, deregulate and put EU bankers at a disadvantage. Regulatory differences put the global system at risk. Lax regulation can create throughout the world. Risk loom on the horizon that could throw the EU and the world bank into recession and causes global conflict. Friedman 15. Europe unable to maintain union will see a return of the nationalism. Europe touches Asia, the Middle East, and Africa. Any other wars could change the entire world. So to speak of war would be preposterous. But Ukraine is a part of Europe, and as was Yugoslavia. Cut the card there. And the 50 state government, the District of Columbia, and all relevant territories of the United States should establish a domestic climate policy to increase output based on the restrictions on the private sector, greenhouse gas emissions, and further development of environmentally unfriendly and alternatives, including crickets. States are the leaders in emissions reduction policy, critical to effective decisions making based on local needs. Anderson et al. 8. State governments lead to the way to the control emissions. Efforts set the stage for future progress, accomplishing significant reductions. These plans reduce GHG emissions by means of a wide range of policies. Reductions are best suited to the unique circumstances of each state. Crucial to gaining political power, provides flexible range of choice by which conflicts may be resolved. The emergence of assisted action by state governments belies any attempts to characterize these as patchwork. State initiatives reflect on bipartisan support. States served as laboratories for other ventures. And on to the case. No impact.
Oh, wait, skip to Millman 16.
Okay.
It's the third part.
Okay. B death on the brink. Millman 16. More than a quarter of Americans, honeybees on Plum County Tower are wiped out over the winter. More than half of the surveyed beekeepers said that they suffered unsustainable losses during the winter over the years. From April 15th to March 16th, beekeepers lost 44% of their colonies, the highest annual loss in record. It's very troubling that what really concerns me, that we are losing colonies to summer too, when bees should be doing well. Bee rules have been pinned to a number of factors, including the mass conversation of pollen, rich metals into the heavy frame. Land for staples such as corn and soybeans numbers have rebounded slightly over the past decades, which suggests beekeepers and deliberately creating more colonies in the expectation they will die off. and a renewable plan leads to killing the bees, we shouldn't need a link card. The app encourages eating of bees, Harvey 16. New research is added to the growing list of the challenges facing the nation's pollutants, agriculture changes in the northern Great Plains could be putting a strain to the honeybees, colonial by infringing on the grassland and other types of land cover are more suitable for pollinators to forage on. A growing national put the card there. And no bee extinction, Hellberger 14. For some people, bees are simply an annoyance. Yet the simple fact is that bees don't exist, do not exist. Neither does humans. Even if we hate bees, we need them. They're responsible for us that we on our plates. Bees perform a task that is vital to the survival of the agriculture, pollination. One third of our global food supply is pollinated by the bees. Many of the crops pollinated by bees. Renowned entomologist. Put the card there. And they don't solve a farmer's goal won't go green on Perna L14. Adaptation for CA is highly heterogeneous. There are fewer than any survivors. Textile varies that explain the adaptation for conversation of agriculture. They relate to the cost and the risk of the CA, the farms and the resources of the farmers, and the time performance. The study highlights social capitals as being widely relevant. And B,
it's going to go. Colonialism.
Okay, colonialism. The plan uniquely spikes food prices. Hill 9. Since agriculture uses a small percentage of the fossil fuels, the burden shall not fall on the sector. The ability of farmers to pass on increased costs is much more limited than any other sector. The diesel fuel manufacturers can't pass on to the tax to the consumers. There is little production product substitution. This is not the case for the farmers, given lack of market concentration and power, and high food prices cause instability in every region of the world. Shortage of crops, fuel instability in key regions. Food experts warn soaring prices are one of the factors contributing to the explosive unrest of Egypt and to Tunisia. The crisis serves as a stark example of what can happen when food prices spiral out of control and access to the existing political problems. Food prices are core to the disturbances. Sharp rise in food prices acted as a catalyst to form political unrest. Unprecedented pressure to the world's ability to feed itself on fuel instability and could lead to an unrest for conflict. Rising food prices could trigger reactions that would exacerbate the problem. Cut card game. And those wars go nuclear priv 10. Modern wars are driven by food. Dufler, Rwanda, Etria, and Blitz and Balkans were all disabled by squabbles over the UK ministry and defense, CIA, CS, IS, and also peace research institutions that identify famine as a trigger for conflict and nuclear war. Put the card there. And structural violence doesn't escalate. They centralize degrees of violence, systems of violence, and not casual to international war. Hank and Pickle 1. Violence is presented in every society. That does not mean that the aggravation is inevitable. Temporary anger does not rise to aggression. While there may be some in common, the basis of individual aggression is aggressive.
Move on.
Okay.
Can you guys send where you cut the cards?
Yeah. Are you guys ready for cross?
Yeah.
Cool. Okay. So.
Can you send over the where you cut cards?
You need the cross for yeah.
Do you want to do crosses and I'll work on it?
Yeah, I'm fine with that. Okay, so you read food price evidence, but all like the actual cards talk about carbon taxes and taxation. So why is that relevant to our app?
Well,
you're
talking about eliminating CO2, right? Emissions, right?
No, sure, but we're not implementing a carbon tax, right? We're implementing like output based restrictions on emissions. So
right, restrictions on emissions.
Sure, but
that's still gonna make food more expensive because the way we get food is highly dependent on
even if we're not raising any commodity prices, it's still going to make food more
expensive.
Yeah,
it's basic economics.
Yeah.
Okay, now on to the bees. Where in the plan do we talk about eating the bees?
Well,
You talk about eating insects.
Right, we talk about eating environmentally and friendly insects. Like,
friendly.
Exactly.
So, I mean, you would agree that eating bees if they're endangered would not be an environmentally friendly practice, right?
I mean, what's the difference of eating crickets or anything else?
Okay,
Okay,
also,
what's the link on the politics to that?
For the politics?
Yeah.
Like the Trump one.
Yeah.
Is there a Movement 16 card?
Okay,
any
describe to me.
Okay, any restrictions on emissions will cause backlash from the red states, and it's going to cause...
Okay, so let's talk about Dodd-Frank. So, when was Dodd-Frank passed? Do you know?
During the Obama administration.
Right, and that means we didn't have Dodd-Frank before the administration, but we still had a stable EU. So why would repealing Dodd-Frank collapse the EU?
Because it's already in place. If you're taking something away, it's still going to cause a reaction.
Okay, and why would Trump willingly want to, if the impacts are as you say, why would Trump willingly lead us to nuclear war and extinction?
You really think Trump is, rational? I mean, he put in a travel ban, which caused major backlash.
Understood.
Right?
I'm just wondering, do you have any evidence saying that a major world leader is going to knowingly lead his country in the
world? We have precedent. He did things that caused major backlash in the past.
Okay.
Why do red states backlash for restrictions?
Because some of these red states are very dependent on these emissions.
Cool. On to this counterplan. You say the states are leaders on environmentally friendly initiatives.
Yeah, you guys also said that. You said that the states...
No, so why don't the states already have active, emissions control measures? Why aren't the states doing this and many other plans? Why doesn't this plan exist in the context of the states?
I feel like it does in many other circumstances. And there's no reason the states can't do it.
Sure, I'm just saying that,
I guess the same goes for, why isn't there a federal...
No, I'm simply... Okay, so what I'm alluding to is, why do you think the states will have the political will to, shortchange their own economy?
Negative fiat.
Okay, that's it for my questions.
I'll
start this off.
Thank you. sent the one with the phone.
I have 4 minutes to use.
I do with 6:05 remaining.
Yeah.
6 what?
6:05.
I got her email, the card cut.
I got the one in Z attached again.
Mm-hmm. Oh, shoot.
No, that was from her.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's marked.
She was like marking where she kept the card.
Okay. Yeah, that's the last email I got.
Case, then the state's counterplan, then the Trump dissad, then the bees dissad, then the line by line, and then answering their food dissad. Cool.
What's the order of case?
Case, I'm going to do case in case order.
Okay.
And then if I have time, we move on to case. But we'll see if that. We are racing against time as the consumption patterns of our nation will lead to the destruction of the mean evidence and Kaufman's 15 evidence states this now is time to push for insect consumption. The intersection between food production and climate change have been ignored in the construction of our domestic climate policy, and that's our CAR 16 evidence. The Arlene evidence points out that the cattle industry alone is one of the largest emitters of greenhouse gases, both domestically and worldwide. WOM 16 tells us that the plan rectifies this gap by increasing restrictions on the private sector emissions by output state, by incentivizing entomophagy as an environmental solution for conservation and animal feed. The GOBOT tells us that our continued consumption rates will drive us past the point of extinction. They have zero links to entomophagy and zero links to output-based restrictions, which is why you opt affirmative. On to case proper. So our plan is has isolated an instance of colonialism that has manifested itself within the diets of the individuals of the West. In our Brown 15 evidence, the West's best mentality is an irrational thinking of why eating a shrimp or lobster is wonderful, but eating an insect, ew, how savage, nearly identical in nature, but one lives in the sea and one lives on land. In the plan, we outline how a shift away from this toxic mentality is uniquely key to deconstructing colonialism on the individual level. Extend our Torres 08 evidence that talks about how the impact of colonialism and structural violence affirmed to approach environmental policy through an anti-colonialist lens. Also, we solve for colonialism on the micro level. We believe that this debate space is key to education, understanding the role we all play within the space and outside these walls, important for not only ourselves but the communities we take part in. Whether you're all down, whether you're down to stop eating meat, or if you just know 1% more about the role of climate policy and the colonialist mentality in our diet, that's a win in our book. We win on the framework. We win on framework, which describes that change must not also be done on a macro level, but also the micro level. Furthermore, extend our terminal impacts that food. They don't touch our food insecurity impact, and they don't touch our deforestation impact, which is why this is already going to be an easy win for the affirmative by the 2A or by the 2AC. And if both teams win on an extinction impact, we will default affirmative on probability. The confluence of agriculture production failures, economic factors, and environmental trends represent the likeliest scenario for devastation of civilization due to disease spread, terrorism, and economic collapse. With brand 19, the biggest threat to global stability is the potential for food crisis in poor countries caused by government and collapse, the crisis brought by enforcing the environmental degradation, one of the toughest things produced. People anticipate some change. The food shortages could break down not every breakdown in individual governments. Also, civilization are continuing to fail with the environmental declines and undermining world food is ever more important. Failing water, stable soil eroding, rising temperature, forcing to conclude that such collapse is possible. Even occurs to you, bioscience in the current world lends an unwelcome support in my conclusion. Cut card. There. So, onto the state's counterplan. One, it's not inherent. Two, the counterplan and it will happen. Counterplan will happen in the status quo. Washington proves that's Publix 16. The ballot measure here is that we can pave the way for the efforts in the other states. It's going to become temporarily. It's going to become potential template for other states, and they have no solvency. Two, the counterplan is illegal. That's gone in 11. The states are not permitted to change a law they're preempted until unless the state or local code adheres to the provision. Federal law sets out the foundation of the preemptive issue of an energy policy. Conservative Act, no regulation concerning energy efficient that energy used or such covered product shall be an efficient use such as product. And we have the net benefit because we have the econ advantage. Federal action is better for business than state action. That's World Resources 12. A single federal policy seeks a level playing for all businesses affected by policy, which could mandate uniform regulation across all 50 states. On to their Trump decides. One, voters don't care about climate change. It's not an issue for them. That's Blackboard 16. It's not a voting issue for most Americans, even most Americans who think climate change isn't an issue. So they have one. They don't have a link to this card. They assume output-based restrictions. Their card does not assume output-based restrictions. It assumes carbon tax, and that's not us. Two, no link to coordination. They concede in the 1AC evidence. We already have a food policy that does not cause their impacts. None of the evidence makes a distinct base on coordinating that policy. Answering the bees decide, which I float on to the paper, in response to their melon evidence, their hobby evidence, and their hot-wing evidence. Ha! Nick, you got us on this one. Seriously, judge this argument should have come a call. We've been running this affirmative all year, and if this is the best advantage to the plan, that's a great reason to vote AF. This is like someone saying that, hey, we should eat sushi, and the next standing up being like, all the guppies are gonna die! So, one, there's no link. Two, the link to their dissent talks about renewable energy. Three, you only evaluate this argument if they provide you the sufficient evidence that the plan will lead to all bees dying because of consumption. Right now, they've got nothing. Even if you want to evaluate this argument without legitimate evidence, extend our run is 15 evidence that over 5 billion people worldwide eat insects regularly. Their argument is non-unique because entomophagy is already happening in the status quo. We haven't died from bee extinction yet. The fourth part of this argument is that, one, they don't have the second no-link argument, is that we speculate in the plan a shift to development environmentally friendly entomophagic alternatives, including crickets, end quote, because bee consumption would not be environmentally friendly, it is not included in the plan. And bees are not key to survival, that's headline, that's Tribune 07, the USDA, top bee researcher Jeff Putter laughs at the idea, Einstein never said it would have. Einstein never said someone made it up. It's incorrectly scientifically there would be food left for humans because wind is food pollinated. And empirically denied, in fact, is empirically denied. Massive die-offs have occurred in the past. Winter losses are normal because the proportion of bee colonies dying in the enormity from year to year. It's difficult to say when a crisis is coming. Only one in a year in 10 outbreaks separately, unusually from heavy colony losses. And skip the next card. I'm gonna go on to the line by line. One, they read a Carter 15 evidence to talk about impact warming. One, we don't read an impact because it's going to kill us all, right? We read how impact is uniquely key to food insecurity and how the affirmative targets food insecurity. They don't have a link to this card. Two, in response to their panel 14 cards that farmers won't go green. This card is outside the context of the affirmative. Judge, all of their cards are not are outside the context of the affirmative. Farmers will go green. They already are right now with the insect consumption. Finally, in their disband 16 card, there is a massive no link. The card talks about the cattle industry used towards the reason to use the card as a reason to vote aft. These assessments overlook greenhouse gas emitted during the manure composting along with the tillage. Evidence suggests that despite the hyperbole surrounding organic farming, and reduced environmental impact are not grounded. Finally, onto their EPA card. This card talks about the status quo and does not account for the growing population and decreasing demand. Extend our lean of six evidence that talks about how the cattle industry, right, it's problematic now, and it's only going to be a threat because we're seeing an increased rise in the population, and we're seeing an increased rise in food consumption, right? Their card, their EPA 14 card, only accounts for the status quo, but in the affirmative, we're already two steps ahead, right? We're already looking at the future. We're saying, hey, look, given the expected population increases, and given the diminishing resources, we need to plan ahead, and this is exactly why you're going to prefer the affirmative, because we outline exactly how we're able to solve for food insecurity that we see right now, and the impact on that is extinction, like I've extended throughout the debate, and they don't answer deforestation card. Extend that deforestation is going to lead to extinction of all humans when we start to chop down the rainforest. That leads to decrease in carbon, decrease to CO2, or decreases oxygen for humans, and we're all going to die, and they don't have a single argument against this. Finally, we win all of our caseloads right now, and additionally, they don't touch our colonialism flow at all, which is important because our colonialism flow is exactly what we're critiquing, right? When they don't engage in the conversation of entomophagy within environmental policy, this is exactly why we need affirmatives like the affirmative that it opens up this taboo dialect, right? We have to engage in environmental policy through an anti-colonialist lens, right? And this is an in-round example of how they are choosing to not engage in this, which is why you're going to prefer the affirmative on all of the cases. And lastly, just to cover my grounds, extend our Slytherin 15 card, extend our Tornin and Yopin 5 card on deforestation, extend our Miller 16 card that talks about how entomophagy is growing now, and the plan is needed to supercharge in a very important alternative, right? We've outlined that the meat is a bad idea. And that's time. Ready for cross.
Okay, so you mentioned solving for colonialism on the micro and macro level. Could you explain how?
Yeah, so our affirmative basically talks about how the reason why we don't see eating insects makes sense, right? We have evidence that they take little water. Already, people around the world are eating insects, right? Why isn't the U.S. eating insects? Because we've stigmatized it, right? We've stigmatized it to be gross. Like I said, shrimp and lobster are super yummy, but insects is like totally bizarre, right? We're saying that we're able to solve for this shift in mindset, right? Through our plan, we're able to encourage the entomophagy movement, and with that, we're able to shift the mindset away from like, ooh, insects, how gross, to just being like a normal, everyday food.
How do you plan on shifting, changing people's mindset?
Yeah, so two ways. So first, our plan is a way to decrease or increase emission or restrictions on cattle industry. What that does is that creates an economic environment in order for the already growing entomophagy movement to thrive. Right? So in that sense, we're not necessarily knocking on people's doors saying, hey, look, you should eat insects. We're saying, hey, look, we're opening up the economic environment to thrive.
Okay, so if all of our arguments are non-unique and everything's already shifting this way, why do we even need the app?
Yeah, so the affirmative talks about how if we continue on the status quo, right, that's going to be
bad. You just said, and to answer all our questions, that that farmers are already going green, and the states are already doing this. So
yeah.
Why do we need the app?
Yeah, we need the app because the entomophagy movement is not on a nationwide level yet, right? The affirmative is needed to make the entomophagy movement as a catalyst across
thank
the nation.
Also,
also
restrictions are
also about bees and cross eggs.
Yeah.
Your partner talked about, he said something like who was talking about eating bees, but in your card 16 card, I believe,
mm-hmm.
it mentions specifically bees. It mentions that the most commonly eaten bugs are beetles, caterpillars, bees, wasps, and ants. So how do you explain that?
Yeah. So
I actually want to get to how the CP is illegal.
Yeah. So when we put restrictions, the states actually aren't mandated to do what you're saying. So it's like illegal, right? It's the federal government that has to carry out these kinds of laws.
And why should we prefer your leeson-schatz card?
Yeah.
When it's like from years back.
Because it gives descriptive analysis on the current situation. Also, we
how is it current if it's years back?
We also read a whole affirmative of evidence that talks about the problems of the cattle industry.
We're asking about this car.
Yeah.
So we
just because things are 10 years old doesn't mean that they're bad signs.
Okay.
But it's not a uniqueness card anymore.
Exactly.
And our other cards talk about it too. So
thank you.
Should we take a press?
Okay.
realize your timing.
Just to give a quick overview with the CP, the states do it best because they avoid the politics this act, and they don't. And yes, my partner will go on more to why they link and why it's still substantial. So bottom-up solutions like this, like the CP, avoid politics. Women 11, America is going to be a leader of Republican rejection of the climate science makes proposal. CPB allows the flexibility and allows the states to charge them clear on climate. There's key to encourage them to start really moderate. Market-based approach of cutting carbon from the bottom up, and empowering states to decentralize climate policy are key for emission reduction and voice politics. Grant et al. 14, national government and international organizations struggle with addressing climate change through legislation. States have launched an incentive that have shown that discovering limited pollution on records of a policy establishment is underlying problem with decentralized students suggest Americans and brand new distinctions without waiting for the congressional gridlock. And states avoid political opposition and gridlock.
and big political gridlock in demonstration of political and national lawmaking for the national government's adoption of the ecology of state functions and policy balance wheel, cut card at balance wheel. Move on to the time frame. The CP works quickly. Christian 14, state governments no longer wait. New York has paved the way, driving states incentive and sense of vulnerable and accountable mayors and governors to are close to ground and hear the constituents and hear what they must. And CP must not overwhelm states. Cut that card. And to go to the why it solves better. States are better for individual engagement, and that's what they want. They want individuals to be for is pissed or eating bugs, and the only way to do that is at the local level. And states that's Brian et al. 8 political movement in states constructed in the action of the United States government by the American support actions. National politics of the nation is by triple amendment fossil fuel out of lobbies. States to love the public, they obliviate this and allow the citizens to influence up the distance, making states permit citizens to petition the direct vote and has ensured investment in initiatives. And states to level reform and action in the basis of progressive reform and movements. Clark 3. The greatest most progressive interest and national interest of progressive reform and gaining success at state 8 levels before generating strength at the prevail nationally because the states serving as laboratories. And state action is key to effective modeling. New law states that you have all countries in America's leadership, but the CPC makes feasible what we've been doing all the way. And the pen has been paid to listen and the negotiators are able to walk into the UN with the momentum. And when the US took action domestically, it could lead. So we have a modeling thing so we could have a net benefit of going into other Western countries, not just the United States. And they never made a modeling plan. And then on to case, well, just to go up to the line by line. They kind of contradict themselves when they say the CP is in the scope, but we can't do the CP. The CP is not in the scope. If it was, then they wouldn't have to act. I answered their federal actions better for business claim, but like we have more modeling, which means we have more people going for the plan. And then, on to case. Extend hand tie. Which basically said that structural violence does not lead to war, and just making analytic structural violence worsens in times of war. The best way to prove that structural violence is declining versus restricting the U.S. administration. Prosperity and global power and prepares the markets and stamp out conflict. They didn't currently look in the indicators of mayors of mortality, income is trending directly high, Kakaya at the right direction. And util is inevitable. Green, when people talk about violence and competition, right, they're already lacking the consolation of the items and language, and extinction outweighs. And we have the fire, faster extinction. My partner will go on that further. Boston 2. Our approach to extinction is not being a primary. We must take a part of the approach. We cannot rely on the more known than that. Our development of experience may be a source of risk. We can take account future generations. And then onto the line by line for their research management quote. They said, now is the time, okay, and again, we can still do that with the CP, and with the CP, we can go further and do some modeling. They never made modeling claims, and we do link to the bees, this app, because if we're putting restrictions on emissions, then these emissions are fossil fuels, and these fossil fuels lead to, if you're decreasing that leads to renewable energy. They're vague. This is a voter for fairness. They don't make specify, and then this makes them to shift any way other, and this is a burden on the neck, and the damage has already been done after the 2AC. And it doesn't matter if the cars are out of context, they still put restrictions on emissions, and the emissions are still being impacted, and if they're being restricted, that means that that means that they're still going to impact it, whether it's through the bees or the food prices decide. So across, let's apply that to all the flows. And so if they're leading to renewables, which they will if they put a restriction on emissions, and these emissions are coming from greenhouse gases, we all can agree on that. They link to the bees and the food prices. And extending on food prices, the food prices will only get worse if they go through the plan because they're emission through a federal level because. I'm gonna read some new cards. I'll send them after. Okay. New York and California set an example for effective state climate change mitigation, Article 16. The CCP is a very significant step in emissions further action that required action to achieve reductions that are taking place at the states. The states have a set of renewable energies in New York and state of California going forward. Regulatory frameworks to speed the transition and efficiently listed with New York's is launched to initiative. And state action is key to effective modeling. I already read a card that said that. And also, doing the state's plan is better because Trump would roll back the plan. Trump ruins everything, but on presumption, Democrat 10. Trump has vowed to defend the BEA, and Trump has named Ebal to head his Ebal transition team, warning may be the sharpest decline in policy and will change under the Trump administration. Mr. Trump may split with the world, there's no way to avoid. Trump has already vowed to cancel last year's Paris Agreement to dismantle the Clean Power Act. Trump can choose not to carry out the Paris plans and slow and weaken enforcement and can do Paris and without the perception of the U.S. and the other governments likely to carry out cuts. And this isn't a restriction, this still leaks. With Trump and the Republican majority, there's little hope it will survive in the Supreme Court with federal action and commitment to Paris. India has now little reason to follow. Trump could direct the EPA to review the plan and friendly issue. Friendly to the industry and could help decimate the budget. So basically, if we do it through the states, we won't have to worry about a Trump rollback because the states are our individual actors. And so basically, we have there's so many net benefits to the counter plan. You get more modeling, you get more people following their path, or the path of the app. You don't link into the dis ads, the politics dis ads, or Trump. These are all multiple reasons to vote neg.
So if the argument on the electronic plan, or if the argument on the disad is that the states are like not about restrictions, then how does your like these red states are about restrictions? How do you actually able to solve the counter plan, right?
Neg fiat.
So how does neg fiat assume that everyone
how are you going to force these states to do anything without a federal mandate?
Especially
if the plan goes through.
If your argument is that states should take on the burden of the plan,
right?
Like you're also arguing.
Are you trying to say that like, why aren't they going to backlash there?
Sure.
Okay. Because just in general, people don't focus on local politics as much, and B, Trump is a celebrity. People are going to look at what Trump does no matter what. And this is going to cause backlash because they expected him to do something and he's not doing
so
that.
So why would that backlash, why would that celebrity argument not apply on the federal scale?
Because Trump's not doing it.
Okay, so your argument is that if this...
It's not just a celebrity thing. It's the level of magnitude or
okay,
the level of influence.
Why can that influence happen on the state scale and not the federal scale?
Because people don't care about state politics as much, that means there's not going to be as much backlash.
Do you have any arguments to, what is the link to these disad, right? We explicitly said that there is no renewable energy, right? That's not what we're doing, and that's what
right,
you're part of saying.
What we're saying is if you're going to put restrictions on emissions, that inevitably it links to renewables.
Okay, do you have any evidence that talks about...
Okay, then what energy sources are we going to be using if we're not using greenhouse gases or like, things that cause emissions?
Okay,
are we just going to be going cavemen?
Your evidence talks about maybe one.
Also, mitigation strategies are a thing, like sequestering. Like, it's not clear that you're going to have to switch through.
See, okay, and that goes back to the vagueness theory argument I made.
Okay, so on your green 2 card that talks about util inevitable, what is the relationship to that and the negative argument with the affirmative?
It was the first card I read?
It was the second card you read on page.
Okay.
Also, while you're at it, can you explain how just because structural violence is decreasing, why we don't need measures against colonialism?
Okay, can you rephrase that question for me?
Yeah, so you can answer my first question first.
Okay. Well, you kind of threw questions at me. Okay, what was the first one again?
The first question was, what is the relationship between your util argument and the affirmative?
Oh, that goes with the handler thing. Do you want to take part with that?
Yeah, sure.
Okay,
yeah, you can see so far the frame.
Okay, so basically, with our Dresner card, it's saying that it's decreasing and util is inevitable, meaning, you can't think of, it's like...
Okay, don't worry about it.
Okay.
We'll figure it out later. Thank you.
Okay, about 50 remain. You said the one R?
Yeah, we're still... there.
No.
Sorry, it's not that.
It was her laptop was spazzing out.
Do you want to use our flashlight?
Okay. Very good.
We
didn't get it.
Did we get it?
We'll let you know when we do.
We'll get flash right now. It's not working.
Yeah, why don't you get the flash ready? I haven't gotten it either.
Do you have a flash drive or do you need one?
No.
Extensions? Do you mean like case extensions?
No.
This
end. Yeah, would it make sense for us to do the case?
No, like more like.
Oh, okay, okay.
Yeah, I'm gonna pull it.
Oh, just let me know.
Yeah.
Would you like the flash?
Oh, was that a yeah?
No, that was a yeah.
Sorry. Alright, I'm good to.
Separation of powers, rule of law, and some representation, constitutional on character and mutual respect for those districts and palaces for over 200 years, for over 2,000 years. Popular rule was widely associated with aggressiveness. The deceived performance of the median voter might well include the ethnic cleansing of political scientists and many feel content using an impressive data set that over the last 200 years of democratizing. Oh my gosh. States went to war significantly more than often, liberal democracies, and also in countries not grounded in constitutional liberalism, the rise of democracy brings hyper-nationalism and war-mongering to the card there. Also, consolidation solves WMD conflict, Parkland 11. Democratic governments are more likely to avoid threats to security, develop and avoid famines economic collapse, that's likely to become fulfilled states or suffer civil war, economic states cooperate dealing with terrorism and proliferation, and WMD, democracy must come from adopted policies necessary to remain on the path of the outside war has come and can make an enormous difference in whether efforts succeed, and global legitimacy of the Supreme Court solves global war, terror, and fills states fulfilled in 8. The court is in charge of interpreting the Constitution. The Constitution plays a major role shaping the engagement of the rest of the world. We need to rebuild alliances. A law has been our best tools. It will be a mistake to abandon leadership. Global spread of the law. Put the card there. Let's move on to
the vote. Finish the card.
Okay. Of the law on leadership matters for fragmentation of power, new dangers of disorder that need to be mitigated by regulatory unpredictability. Only the role of the law can provide. And also food prices spike, cause extinction, agriculture are key to foreign aid and diplomacy that diffuse tensions and heighten cooperation among allies. The alternative is global starvation, killing billions, and worldwide resource wars. That's Crib and Harvey. Turn to their case. A. Small farms key to solving warming. Artery 8. Farmers are essential importance for foods to protect the environment. Production has to remain in the hands of the small scale farmers. Only by changing industrial agriculture can environmental degradation be halted. Also, the small farming compromises has for the
survival.
Right. And also B, price volatility kills the ass signal.
Okay. Alright, we'll take some prep. Some case stuff on like
color.
Yeah,
cards, right?
Okay, cool. And
do you have answers to the case stuff?
Case?
Yeah.
You do. I think so. When you say answers to case stuff, you mean like 35 So, like, alright, stop prep at, we used a minute 46 in this last...
Okay, 4:04 prep.
Alright, 4:04?
Yep, mine. Yeah, so...
Do you
need
one breath?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Wait,
your basic mock-up?
No.
Oh, okay. Thanks for keeping time.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm not going to read any, or actually I'll read two new parts, maybe. So I'll just email those out to you guys. Are you guys like good to go?
I don't have the cards.
Okay, I mean, there's only two of them and I sent them to you like.
Why don't you flash it?
Okay. I want to give it another minute and then.
I got it.
Okay, cool. Judge, are you. Like, do you have it?
No, I did get it, but I did not get the email.
Okay, Alright, well then I'll just start. Okay, so they don't answer our framework arguments. The role of the ballot should be given to.
They did not get the email. Okay.
Oh, I thought you said you got the
email.
No, roadmap.
Okay, right. So we're gonna go. How are you flowing food? Are you flowing it? Because I have it as like an independent. It started off under the colonialism flow, but they kind of made it like an independent.
It's
DA.
On the case debate.
Yeah, okay, so I'm gonna go. Overview, then bees, then Trump, then counterplan, then case. And order of case is going to be food, then colonialism, and then defo, and then one, or like food and security.
Okay.
Cool. All right. So we don't enter a framework argument. The role of the ballot should be given to the team that can provide the best education within this debate space. Not only are we winning on the flow debate where the kernel impacts deforestation and food insecurity, but also curating in-ground education by engaging in traditionally stigmatized and taboo approaches to environmental policy. Judge, you can stop an instance of colonialism and structural violence in our perceptions of food through the app. They have no specific indictments of entomophily. You need to get full weight on our impacts. Also, all their links are based on carbon tax restrictions. This doesn't matter because it's, like, they say it doesn't matter because it's all the same. It is not. Policy matter, nuance matters, generalizations lead to lazy debating. We're going to talk about that more under the case. Onto the case advantages, they don't have a single card on resource degradation. We win on the probability of food insecurity impact, which is Lopez 98, which is it's happening now. We also extend Quillian 15, which says that entomophagy is key to solve. They don't have ink on the flow. Okay, so overall, this, you're going to vote AF because we're the only ones that actually solve for extinction and talk about social violence. They don't talk about anything except warming, which means we still solve for extinction through food wars, global pandemics, oxygen depletion. We don't link to bees because we don't call for entomophagy in environmentally destructive instances. We gave you impact defense. As for Trump, we showed you the plan is illegal. We also gave you impact defense. We're going to show you that they don't have an internal link between EU recession and EU dissolution. Okay, so onto bees. I said my partner's arguments, which they didn't respond to, that we don't talk about renewables. Output-based restrictions are fundamentally different than renewable technology. They don't have a link. You also, their impact card is predicated on a world without bees, which they do not link us to. So the art, and the fact that they mention that people are eating bees right now turns the case, right? The people are eating bees, we're fine, what's the problem? So also, so on bee, we're not calling for entomophagy, period. We're calling for a far more nuanced view, which says that we're calling for environmentally friendly alternatives, including crickets. So it's a double bind. Either eating bees is in our plan, which means it's fine, or it's not in our plan, which means it doesn't matter. We also haven't responded to the status quo, and just to settle the impact, we're going to read you some more evidence. The current supply of honeybees is used for an important agricultural purpose. Turn their DA evidence. Farmers are unlikely to stop buying bees just because other people want them. Any increased demand for bees is likely to be met by increased supply, not by cannibalizing the existing industry. Honeybees provide an essential pollination service to U.S. fruit, vegetable, and seed growers, adding 8 to 14 billion annually to farm income and ensuring a continuous supply of healthy and affordable food to the consumer. About 2 million colonies are rented by growers each year to service over 90 crops acquired. So basically, farmers use these bees. They have big demand. That's not going to go away just because other people demand bees too. We expect an increase in supply. On to Trump. First of all, they dropped Jackie's argument that this is not going to be a major political issue. That's Lepowski 16. Voters don't really care about climate change to the degree that the negative is telling you. They dropped it. Also, you're not going to vote on this yet because it's missing an internal link. They say that the plan is going to cause Trump to repeal Dodd-Frank, which is going to cause the EU to dissolve, which is going to cause a major war. But their evidence doesn't say that. Their Relaying 210 evidence says that repealing Dodd-Frank could push the EU into recession, and their Friedman evidence says that a war without the EU is really bad. What we're missing is a story on how pushing the EU into recession causes it to dissolve. It's also that they haven't linked the DA to our plan. It's not clear that Trump dealing a political blow is going to cause him to invoke the nuclear option. He's been faced with a bevy of political blows since the day he was inaugurated. He has not yet invoked the nuclear option. Okay, onto the counterplan. It's illogical on its face. You cannot force the states to do something without a federal mandate. That's the only technique which could be used. So the CP is illegal. They didn't push back.
It's coming to London. Federal law regulates energy use and efficiency. States are not permitted to change that law. They are preempted unless a state or local code adheres to an exception provision. Federal law sets up the foundation of the extradition of the Energy Policy and Conservation Act cut part. So we have a specific law that their counterplan is violating, and they haven't really pushed back on this. Also, on to the line by line. All the evidence talks about congressional gridlock, but voting aft renders that question moot. Even if you believe states are more efficient than the federal government, they haven't impacted this besides the Trump DA. If that doesn't hold up, there's no reason to vote on the counterplan. Also, they talk about modeling, that's GAS 15. That's all based on state support of the federal Clean Power Plan. This was created by the federal EPA under our President Obama. Its fate will be determined by the Supreme Court. Even if you believe state action could supplement federal action, they haven't given you a case to support one over the other. It's simply all their evidence is about the states following a federal lead. On to food. All their food evidence is written with carbon tax warrants. That's Shashinsky and Hill 09. They said in Cross that we're going to increase food prices without increasing any commodity prices. That doesn't make any sense. We also read tons of evidence about how crickets are cheaper for food rearing and livestock feeding and conventional farming, and how they gave people the ability to grow their own food. That's Miller and Evans, which says insects are small and easy to breed without much investment capital and land needed. This could empower the poor and other marginalized groups, such as women in the rural poor, to produce their own food. They haven't responded to that at all. You're going to vote off on case because even under their framework, we win. We present three distinct extinction scenarios, DFO, pandemics, and food insecurity, and we're the only ones who have talked about structural violence, which our multi-notorious evidence describes as a hellish existence replete with rape, war, murder, rape, and racism. These impacts win on time frame because they're happening now. They win on probability because it's easy to imagine how a lack of food, a pandemic, or a war could lead to extinction. Their B scenario is likely because one, people already eat bees. Two, we aren't all sure that all bees are going to go extinct under the plan. Three, their impact under the EU food prices thing is nuclear war, which we have not had since 1945. So it is not likely. On to colonialism. They haven't put anything really on this part of the flow. So just to rehash the story, we're talking about in-route education, right? That's the framework we advocated for this debate, which they haven't really given you a reason that this should not be adopted. All they said is util inevitable. Well, it's not if you adopt our framework. We are the only ones who are advocating breaking down colonialism. We are the only ones who are advocating, you know, fighting this Western hegemony as it's manifested in dietary preferences by removing the stigma about eating insects. They haven't talked about this at all. And onto food insecurity, they lose the entire impact debate on one part, which is Brown, which they didn't dispute, which says the biggest threat to global stability is the potential for food crises in poor countries to cause government collapse. We read this evidence in the 2AC, they left it on the table, you know, so that's just, you know, taken as undisputed during this debate. So to sum it up, they haven't given you a clear reason not to use our framework, and even under their framework, we ran on a bevy of impacts, and their DAs just don't work.
401.
Okay, let's do game of soccer real quick.
Thank you.
argument in the front. Okay. Theory, they simply did not answer any of my theory arguments. However weak they may have been, they conceded to 100%, meaning that you should vote neg and for in ground means that they've made the act a constant moving target, which is the neg can never hit. They keep saying, yes, we restrict GHS. No. Yes, they're from fossil fuels. No, we don't lease renewables. We don't link to any of your DAs. They literally have tried to spike out every link, making it impossible burden to be neg. Don't let them answer this in the 2AR. It's far too late in the debate, and the abuse has already occurred. Okay, then on to the DA. Extend or secure a 97th card, genocide and war for 2,000 years. Okay. First, just to give an overview of the story. So red states, Democrats are cooperating with Trump right now for the Gorsuch nomination, but the willingness depends on the calculation of their home state politics. That's Davis 9-7-2-9. And they need Democrats. And they can't get that if we do the plan, because it is in emissions restrictions. They have said that it is, and that's our link. That's more than 16, and that causes backlash. And that backlash goes to nuclear options bill, which is a frame repeal that's called for 2-2. Republicans, if they couldn't get the 60, could cut and filibuster for 51, and that's going nuclear, the code option for wipeout civility, and not only carbon nomination, but other legislation that Trump wants to pass. And that leads to the collapse of the EU. Our internal link is inside the evidence. It says the pledges to roll back the Dodd-Frank Act along with the Brexit puts and in the precautions. So if they read our card, they know that the link is within the card, and the bloc may lose its financial center. And that leads to this global conflict, that's Freedom 15, and this conflict can maintain the unity of nationalism, and this can touch from Middle East to Africa. So we're winning on time frame on this, because the nuclear escalation takes a matter of seconds, and magnitude, you can only die once, and a probability, or, and that's why that's the net benefit to the CP, and that's why we need the CP, because state leaders are in emission reduction policy are critical to effective decision making. Extending those cards, bottom-up solutions like the CP avoid politics, that's going to be in 16, of 15, American leaders should, do it in there, and again, they said, keep on saying, doesn't this happen in the, state level, but, people aren't as focused on the state level, so, they could pass it easily and they could feel positive without any lashback. And this avoids congressional backlash as well. That's the proof from California. That's our Corral 12 card. Go to the CP works faster than theirs does. That's our Christian 14 card. States incentives are a sense of vulnerability. So that's what the act is, it's an incentive. And that causes mayors to lose their ground. States are better for, they never answered this claim, that states are better for individual engagement. If they do want to have the ASA lead to eating bugs, then this is the way to do it, because states are better for individual engagement. And to answer that, their claim that it is illegal, they never extended the warrants to the card and how it's illegal adequately enough. They said that it's illegal because it does energy, but energy efficiency, but this isn't this was from 2011, and they never contested that this hasn't been updated or and even if we don't get the benefit or the DA to or the net benefit from the politics DA, they never answered our Trump presumption argument that he will roll back the plan if it is through the federal government. That means means the state are a better approach. And even if you don't vote for the CP, that still means that they don't have solvency, and they never refuted that. And so vote on presumption, and they can't make any new R's in the 2AR. So onto the case. Again, they keep making it a moving target. They talk about how they're not linked to renewables, so the V's are out, and they keep saying that. But basically they didn't answer our engagement argument, and just an overview, we're winning on time frame, we're winning on magnitude, and they never answered our theory arc or our Trump presumption card, and those are two heavy cards, which A, they don't get solvency, or B, they made it very difficult to be the neg in this round. That's time.
Four. Time around.
I have been keeping track of time.
Wonderful.
Deforestation impact or our food insecurity impact. When they concede our Lopez 98 card that talks about the food insecurity is the likeliest scenario to extinction, they concede this early on in the debate and they don't even bring it up at all throughout the debate, right? They're completely missing what the objective of the affirmative is to do, which means that we still garner all of our advantages through the extinction impact through our Lopez 98 card and through our deforestation impact, which they also don't mention, which is through our Suthrin 15 card. We also went on the probability, right? We've read throughout the round that this is the most likely scenario when people don't have food, when people, like we've seen in the Arab Spring, right? When people, the food vendors, right, that didn't have food, that couldn't support their families, that took the streets, right, and rioted, right? We're saying that this is exactly the kind of action that we're going to be seeing if we don't implement the plan and create a way to solve for a better food policy and a better way to maintain the consumption patterns now. And look, even if you wanted to give them the Trump disad and the food prices disad, all of these stuff on case, in the 2AC, we set up the framework, which you should judge this round. We prioritize the importance of in-round education, which they don't talk about at all, which is why you're going to prefer the ask, because we maximize education not only within the round, but also outside the round. If they wanted to win on this argument, they should have given us reasons why you should prefer terminal impacts and not in-round impacts, right? We're saying that we still garner all of our advantages within talking about taboo things that have been traditionally underrepresented in the discussion of climate change. They don't answer any of these arguments. And like I said, the role of the ballot should be given to the team who can provide education within this debate space. Not only are we winning on the debate flow and all of our terminal impacts, but also encouraging for a debate space to open up things that have been traditionally taboo is extremely important. And they continue to not engage with the colonialism mindset and the colonialism advantage, which is exactly why you're going to prefer the affirmative, and it's exactly why you should be affirming teams that open up things that have been traditionally stigmatized. You can stop if by voting affirmative, right? You're able to promote a way to stop colonialism within this instant or within this debate room, to stop the structural violence in our food perceptions of food through the app. They have no specific indicts of entomophagy, which is why we get the full weight of the impact. And something additional to note is that if you're looking at the round through this framework, all of their links throughout this entire debate have been on carbon tax, right? And they stood up and were like, hey, well, it doesn't matter, or hey, like, you're a moving target. No, this affirmative has been on the wiki since September, right? The fact that we're not a moving target, you guys just didn't cut evidence that links to our affirmative. And these generalizations, right, them coming in and saying that any restriction is a bad idea, is a reason why you should prefer the affirmative within this framework, because when you stand up and just say any restriction is bad, right? This isn't how policy works. Policy, we need to think about the specifics, right? We need to debate the specifics of output-based restrictions. We need to debate the specifics of the plan. And the affirmative is just reading generic disads to a very specific plan that has a very detailed methodology, and they are just reading general
general dissad, and that's not good for education because they're not able to clash on the specifics, which is actually how debate works in the real world, which is exactly why you're going to vote affirmative under the framework, because we're better for education, right? We provide these details, we provide the specificity that's able to engage in better debates that spill outside of this room. Finally, even if you're not going to go for the framework argument, we still win on both of our case advantages. There's not a single flow, again, on the food insecurity, there's not a single flow about how they didn't argue at all that entomophagy is key to food insecurity. They concede this, right? They concede the all of our arguments that talk about how the plan is needed, right? So if they concede that the plan is the arguments that are made on the affirmative, that means that we still are able to garner all of those advantages. Also, the theory argument that they made in the last speech, they don't extend any impact to that, which is why you're going to prefer our internal education and impact, which spills over into the outside world. Finally, onto the dissad, that's the only thing that they really have going for them coming out of the 2NR. You're not going to prefer the dissad because, one, they conceded our Lopez, their Lowski evidence that talk about how we read that people don't care about climate, right? People care, in the election, it didn't come back down to, like, the climate debate, it came down to immigration, it came down to economic policy, right? We're saying that you don't have a specific link to our output-based restrictions. Your evidence is based on modeling for carbon tax. And two, even if it was unique to our plan, right? We're saying that you don't get the extinction of the dissad. Finally, the counterplan. They concede that it's illegal. They can't. They don't answer any of the arguments. You can't do the counterplan because it's not a real thing. And then lastly. We win on probability, as you've read before. y'all mind if I run to the restroom really quick?
Are you about to?
I was actually just about to start.
Okay,
no,
that'll wait.
Sorry.
No, perfect.
Yeah, let me just flip the camera.
Let me just put the coin
in.
Alright, so I end up voting for the affirmative campaign. And the reason, I mean, the big reason why I do is that you don't make really the obvious necessary answer in response to like the in-route education is that your state's counter plan would also be that form of education because we would still get the education about how we shouldn't necessarily be able to eat, how we shouldn't eat bugs within the context of this space. And this is definitely different than just sort of like extinction structural violence because this is what, you know, education versus the world of like what happens post implementation. And so this argument is, I mean, is made very clearly in the 2AC and the 1AR, and it's not answered in either place. And like the 2AR goes sort of like all in on it, so it's difficult for me to sort of like look past it, given that it's been a consistent thread throughout the debate that is not really getting answered. I think that absent that, I think that the 2AR is not getting to the counterplan with enough time, and the one answer that you're making there that it's just illegal is, as they point out in cross-examination, I think solved by negative fiat because they're able to fiat the 50 states acting in conjunction, so we can have a debate about whether or not this should be done at the federal or local or at the local state level. Now you can make arguments for why state implementation is ineffective and federal government implementation is effective, and in fact the 2AC has those arguments, right? And so the 1AR should go to those arguments opposed to it's illegal, which is the one argument that's solved for, because all of the impact analysis you start with the 2AR is irrelevant if the counterplan solves for your case, and there's no argument for why the counterplan doesn't solve for the case, which means it captures all of that various solvency, and there's only risk that Trump might be able to roll these sort of things, you know, roll these sort of policies back. And so you need to make sure that you're turning the level of the counterplan. I'm probably making a permutation with that as well.
Okay.
However, and this is you know, I initially start thinking about like, okay, so I'm going to vote on the counterplan, but when going through the rest of the debate, there's no articulation of how that counterplan actually solves for the case in relationship to, like, you know.
So we should have just said that it solves for
the in-route education.
Okay.
Like, I mean, it really sort of isn't because you're just like, hey, the state can do it too. You're not really giving us any of that form of education. But yeah, but like that's the type of education that's a necessary form of education that allows us to understand who should be pushing forth these individual policies or something along those lines. Or just an argument that's like, when you're talking, like when you're reading your arguments about, like when you're making your extinction arguments, make the argument that means that we have to debate about these things in this room and in this space. So talking about how policy gets implemented is more important than just talking about how, you know, a Western approach of being like, ew, bugs, is colonialist, that's a secondary question because we need to get the education on these policy conversations. Versus, the counterplan is going to solve because we're going to be able to do the same thing as the app. That doesn't link to the dissad, therefore we're able to solve for extinction, which assumes all of that world of like the plan being implemented, which is the same world that the top of the 2AR is, which is why the top of the 2AR does nothing for you in this debate, because I think that in that world, you're losing the counterplan, because I think the counterplan solves for your affirmative. However, because your 2AR does actually, you know, do the necessary thing going all in terms of like the in-route education, that doesn't end up hurting you in this round. And if you would have just been like, extend the in-ground education, they never answer, we talk and promote this anti-colonial mindset, and then move down to other ways, I would not be voting on sort of the in-ground education. Sort of like the ability to collapse in terms of the 2AR was a good choice, but I think that you also needed to say something more effective on the other portions, because if a judge doesn't vote for that, then you're going to end up losing on sort of those individual policy conversations.
Yeah.
And so I think that what you need to ask yourself in terms of going into prepping the 2AR is what can you potentially lose on, and not just what are you winning on, right? Because you correctly identify that you're winning on the counterplan and the disadvantage. Though on the disadvantage, you aren't answering that essentially the low-key evidence is that people just don't care about climate change, so there is sort of a compelling known link story there. But aside from that, a risk of a link doesn't matter. You know, as long as there's a small chance of a link if the counterplan solves, it's sort of an easy story, but you need to then figure out what's the thing that someone can collapse to. If the 2AR didn't collapse in that way, I think you would have, it would be, you know, it'd be much, much better in your favor in that regard. I would also say that in terms of moving target, not moving target, extending that, that's something that, how I made the comment, the collapse gets me in the 2AR. You did the quick extension moving on more so, which is not going to be as convincing, because in this instance, I don't understand what exactly about them made them a moving target, right? And so, I mean, they say environmentally friendly, you know, insect consumption, like crickets, which could be, like, not bees, because that's not environmentally friendly, but then their feed-eating past any sort of insect, like if you group cricket eating, was environmentally destructive, then they would be not crickets, or not those type of crickets, so that'd be environmentally destructive, right? So this is an instance of where they're literally feed-eating that we will only eat bees, or only eat insects that have no damage on the environment. And so it's like, well, how can you, like, that does literally make it impossible to debate, because anytime you have a dissent to any individual insect, then they just say not this insect. But they aren't really being a moving target, because it's sort of been clear that this is what they're doing. But it's, you know, also unfair. So I don't think that like they're shifting around their story so much as that they're trying to be through solvency. But if you could at least point out, like, directly where you think the shifts have happened in the debate, then it'd be easier for me to see how that would be unfair. But when you are reading just carbon tax or generic links, like, their no link argument is not coming from the fact that they're shifting around. It's just that you're reading, you know, not great links in this instance. And so I don't really, so that argument is not as compelling to me. So, yeah, to sum it up, 2NR, ask what you can lose on. If the 2NR makes the argument about how you also provide that in-right education, or how education on policy making is necessary, then that answers the impact, the framing of how I approach around in terms of education, because it's like the way that the ballot should be understood in the debate, and so there's no counter understanding of how that ballot should be understood differently. So I would also say that once you, and then the shortened version for you, is that once you have made the decision that you're going to go for that framing of the debate, realize that everything else that you're doing on that policy world doesn't matter, and so you should sequence that as an even if, so it's not we're winning the debate because we solved for the quickest extinction, because we no longer don't. If the role of the ballot is about in-round education, because there is no quick extinction in that world, right?
Okay.
And so especially then, in terms of time allocation, is all that time spent on that impact analysis is useless in the policy world versus the counterplan, but your role of the ballot makes both of those irrelevant, so if you then frame and do more work there, that's where your time should be spent. And
yeah.
Then the other role is that even if you don't buy this framing, then go on to the impact, you know, your impact on the counterplan doesn't get that. You do sort of the reverse of that in the 2AR.
How do we do reverse?
You start with we win because of our impact,
oh,
we solve extinction, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Then you do the role of the ballot, which
yeah.
is everything.
Even if you
reverse.
Don't buy that, yeah.
Right.
No, I understand why that doesn't really make sense.
Yeah, frame it the one thing that's clear that you're going to win on opposed to the other.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Got
and
it.
Then 1AR, go for the better, more relevant answers on the counterplan. Which are just sort of like that the economic is better on the federal versus the state, which is one